p.m. Central Time. Some of you were able to get a copy of today's agenda, and others got a copy of last year's minutes if you're interested. Extra copies are available. I also have some copies up here if needed. So the meeting will now come to order. I'd like to start by introducing the board members. Starting at my left is Matt Hall, Kevin Axtell, and Aaron Stevens, Richard Kennison, myself and Kim Lair, board member Tom Wall, and our board member and renowned treasurer, Kevin Macbeth. I would also like to introduce to my right, Jeanette Williams. Jeanette Williams is a professional parliamentarian who is here to preside over today's meeting. To help us with today's meeting. Sorry about that. All right, the secretary, the recording secretary, Brandy Axtell, is not able to be present today at this meeting. If there is no objection, Richard Kennison has volunteered to serve as secretary pro tem for this meeting. Is there anyone in objection to that? Since there is no objection, Richard Kennison is appointed secretary pro tem. Next item of business is the adoption of today's agenda. The agenda, as I said, has been distributed. If anyone does need one, please come up. We'll make sure that as many of you get one as necessary. Is there any discussion on today's agenda? Okay, if there's no discussion, are we ready to vote? And this is just to vote for to approve the agenda. And we are following Robert's Rules of Order so that everyone in attendance does vote on this. If you are ready to vote, all those in favor of adopting today's agenda, subject to emergency change. Oh, sorry, Brian. Question? Oh, you're in favor. All right, sorry. All those, question. We had to count them to get quorum, but according to our bylaws, once quorum is achieved, it doesn't matter how many are in the actual room. Yeah, technically they are, yes.
What?
Yeah.
It's at least 100.
Yeah, Sean.
It's a membership meeting. So at membership meetings, according to our bylaws, we need at least 100 members in attendance when we vote for quorum, which is what we went to do over at the gym. You're welcome. Any other questions? Hearing none, all those in favor of adopting the agenda, subject to emergency change, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, say no. The ayes have it, and the agenda is adopted, subject to emergency change. The minutes of the 2010 membership meeting were approved by the Board of Directors in August of 2010. They have been copied and distributed. If you are interested in looking at those, they are online. But we can also make more copies for you here after the meeting if you wish. For those that have, the next item of business is reports. Mike Sullivan, is he here? Okay, he probably has something he has to do. If we could skip, that's okay, he's probably taking care of something. Okay, we're gonna skip to the next report, which is the Iwi Fest Fund Committee. Matt Hall.
Okay. So, the basic, for those of you who are unaware of what this, what we're talking about, is a anonymous donor who shall be known as Iwi or Iwi?
I pronounce
Iwi. I go Iwi, okay, anyway. Anonymous donor X, no, E, Kiwi, gave the IJA $50,000 last year. And then there was a further commitment to $50,000 every year for the next 20 years. The money is apportioned according to Iwi's wishes. I believe, what was it, $20,000 or $25,000 into savings? $25,000 into savings, $5,000 to the YEP program, and that leaves us with $20,000 to spend on the festival. And then that $20,000 spent on the festival must be, quote, for the improving the enjoyment of all festival goers, in essence. So what we did was form a committee. Starting last year, we met four different times via conference call, and kind of argued out. At first, we of course solicited ideas both on erect dot juggling on the IJA forum, so on and so forth. People wrote ideas to us. We vetted them. We talked about all of them, voted on them, and we ended up with what you're experiencing this week. And you may not know it. In fact, I think we've been amiss. We should have put some signs up in certain places saying, this is brought to you by IWI, so you know that money went to that particular fun thing. But I have it. It was posted actually on rec.juggling and on the IJA forum several months ago when we made our final decision, when they were recommended to the board. The board voted on them and confirmed them. And IWI also has a say in that. He or she doesn't have necessarily veto power, but IWI can, of course, give us recommendations. So what we ended up with is as follows, just to confirm. X-Juggling received a $500 grant to help Jack Calvin pay for expenses that he's been covering up to now out of his pocket. Medals, t-shirts, and the rental of DJs, so on and so forth. $750 went to Juggling, to Len Furman, to upgrade the awards. You just noticed some of the t-shirts you've seen this week, the blue ones, those of you who are at Juggling. Anybody jugglers? You might have seen that. Purchasing of water, I think you want to get some sunshades and things, especially here this week. That was necessary. He was smart to think ahead. The fire nights that started last night, I believe, will continue tonight. $500 went to that, and that was to pay Rochester Fire Department to be on site. Actually, believe it or not, they were not required. The city did not require any such permits for them to be there, which is usually not the case. But we thought it prudent just to make sure they're there and pay them for their time, of course. Just like if you were to hire off-duty police officers to cover a school dance and so forth. So, $500 went to that. IJA collectibles. $1,400 was allocated for a little keepsake, which in this case was a Dunkin' Yo-Yo with the IJA logo on it, as well as the trading cards for, and I want to make sure, they're all locked in one chunk. So those of you who got your yo-yo and trading cards, thank IWI for it. And if you didn't get one, let us know, because we certainly have more. Next up, publicity photos, gym photographer, Mike Sullivan. We sent $2,000 his way so we could hire a photographer to take professional shots for up-and-coming jugglers who maybe want to start building their portfolio. Because it's hard to get good juggling shots that you can send to companies or to agents. That's $2,000. Street bus apartment, correction. The collectible yo-yos, Jack Kelly, $1,400, and then IJ train cards, Jack Kelly, $1,000. So total $2,400 spent on those collectibles. Then the publicity photos, as mentioned. And then next up, the street busking competition run by Dave Pawson. And that's going to happen Friday? Friday at 1:30, yes? 1 to 3 outside of this location. And the money was mainly used for prize money. There are some expenses and permits to be had. I think it was like 50 for one permit, 40 for another, 25 for another, he just told me about it. So most of the money is going to go to the prize money for people who win the busking competition. Next up, $2,500 to Andy Peterson Slammin from New York for the gauntlets.
Did you say how much went for the busking competition?
$2,500 also. And $2,500 equally to the gauntlet, the building of the gauntlet. And once again, those of you who haven't seen it, go check it out. If you haven't juggled on it yet, have fun with it. It's fantastic. It's an idea that Simon Andy's been had for years, and he finally got the money to do it. I want to thank also Crash and Mark Hayward, who helped him build it and really finesse it and design it. I also want to thank Tom and Penny Tesserick, who basically housed the building of it this week in Minneapolis, and then they all schlepped it over here. I think it's great. Next up, the lounge. All those couches, pool table, pinball machine, the TV rentals, everything out in that hallway. That hallway should be empty, essentially. All of that was procured and organized by Warren Hammond. And I think he did a great job once again. It's great stuff. He's not here, but it's okay. I think we had one of the Wii's was stolen. Like on the first night. And that Wii, a rookie move on our part, we kind of just left it there because we assumed that jugglers would be cool and it was stolen probably by somebody offsite. So that's a shame, but oh well. The main rentals, that money pays for the rental, and then we return the rentals and they pick it up. Some of the things we purchased, we're either going to donate to Salvation Army, again, like some of the, you know, the electronics or what have you, and or we thought about doing a raffle for it as well to raise money and defray some of the costs. Give us your opinions on that, love to hear that. And then, where were we? Two more.
What was purchased as opposed to rental?
The Wii. And the board games, you know the board games are out there? Those were purchased. Oh yeah, because they actually went to Salvation Army and purchased some of the couches for like $10, not $10, but they purchased them and I think they're gonna give them back. And then some of the Wii controls, they were purchased used, but they have a 7-day return policy, who's gonna return them? That's not gonna happen, but anyway, you get the point. And then two more, I'm sorry? The pinball machine was rented.
TVs are rented from a place called Meeting Tomorrow, and all the game tables, the pool table, the billiards, the pool table, the pinball machine, the darts,
foosball,
they were all rented from a different company.
So if you have problems with those, come see me or come see Warren Hamlin. We can try and get them fixed like we can if something's broken, the ball's stuck or something like that. But it's going good. I think people are treating them well. I think it really adds to the flavor of the festival. I've been to several festivals like Turbo in Montreal and EJC, where they have lounges like that where people can just hang out and eat and talk and relax.
Paul was talking to me about it yesterday.
Okay, Paul, we're on it. Yes, who?
I don't know if this is out of order, what the discussion is, but Todd has also got the Mayo Clinic here. What about Ronald McDonald House or Mayo Clinic?
Excellent idea. We'll talk about it, for sure. And it's not out of order, so it's cool. Yes, sir.
When I asked you for input for the Austin Festival, you mentioned having beer. So where's the beer?
That was actually brought up. Once again, the seven of us on the committee pretty much went over every single one, right? And we didn't demand, like I as chair of the committee, I didn't kind of chair the meeting such that I demand unanimity, you know, not unanimity.
Huh.
Yeah, unanimity. Unanimous. Right? I said, let's see if we can get to 6-1, 7-0 on things. We should agree. If it's 4-3, we need to choose another idea to spend money on. So, you know, we chose, like, the trading cards, and that was a 7-0 vote. And I'm like, okay, we have $19,000 more to spend. Beer didn't meet that standard. Not everybody on the committee thought it was a good idea, so it didn't work. We talked about, and also there are procedural liabilities. For IJA, purchasing liquor for IJA members to then consume and then go die. That's a problem.
Dying on the gauntlet.
Or elsewhere. You walk outside and fall down and hit your head and you had one beer. Legally, that's not cool.
Question?
Yes, sir.
Can the $20,000 available for one fund be spent on insurance to cover things like that?
No. No, we have specified that it's to be spent on fun things, not bread and butter issues that should be covered.
Like insurance to cover fun things. Like if we had a bounce.
I see what
insurance could be.
I see what you're saying. I don't know. I'd have to ask Iwi and see if that's okay. My personal feeling is that why do that when you find other fun things that you're not gonna waste $1,000 on an insurance premium when you spend $1,000 on something cool. But then again, beer. Or a bouncing castle, or a bounce house. Okay, so, yes?
Mm-hmm.
all I'm going to say to that is, I was a counselor on a teenage psychiatric unit, and I'm a high school teacher, so certainly my views on the law are my own. But on the other hand, I've been to several European drug conventions and several international festivals where alcohol is a part of the culture, it's a part of fun, it's not abused, and I view it that way as well. But back to you, you see, there's a tension here. It's not everybody wants it. So we wanted to go with things that we thought would be winners, no matter who it was. Like a bounce house. Or the gauntlet. Or, wait, there will be a surprise. $1,500 was donated or made for a surprise that will happen at Renegade. Pardon me? All three. All three nights. No, same surprise every night. And that's all I'm going to say. I'm not going to give it away. You're not going to, no Jedi mind tricks on me, no. And then last but not least, the gala show honorarium. Once again, this was something that we argued back and forth about because certainly the IJA and its general festival budgets for VIP performers like Stefan Singh, Christiana, Look Sharp, Victor Yedenberg, and those guys to come over, pay for their flights, hook them up with hotels, honorarium for food and so forth. But we also wanted to try and use some of this Ivy money to give them a little something extra, a little honorary, maybe $100, $200, $250 per act. You know, you can't give $100 per person to the Jugheads because they're one of the VIP guests, but it's like $400 of them, maybe. It's not gonna work. But we were trying to find the right number. We originally budgeted that number, and we thought that's a good way to get a good reputation internationally. When these guests who come here, we treat them well, they go back to their home countries and say, oh man, yeah, the IJA treated me like gold, and you should definitely do that gig, or it's a good fest. So we had that money, and then things happened. We lost a couple of flights that were originally priced at this. The flight goes up, fuel costs go up. So the honorarium money is no longer there. It was then used to cover their basic hotel flights and per diem. That was really the $3,000 was originally budgeted for that, but they're not going to get it. We'll try and do it again maybe next year. Question?
When people have questions, if you can repeat them so we can hear them a little
bit. Oh, certainly.
Thank you.
So that is the fun for 2011, this festival. Before this festival ends, I'm going to have a Survey Monkey up online. We'll post it on the forum. We'll post it on the whiteboard at workshops where you can go on and you can give your feedback. Hey, and it'll be line item. Everything I just talked about, rated 1 through 5. Do you think it was great? Did we waste our money? Did we make good use of our money? That'll be for fun. There'll also be one for workshops as well, but that's a different issue. So that's good. And then now I know some people here want to talk about 2012 fun. That's, once again, not going to happen right this second, but certainly we can talk about it in open business if you want to make a motion, or if you want to volunteer to be on next year's fun committee. That's the only way to get your voice heard, really, is to be one of those 7 people, have a seat at the grown-ups table, cast your vote, and advocate for the thing. I was an advocate for using the Ivy money to increase the prize money for the IJA championships. But that's general fund money, and there's ways to do that without using the Ivy money. You know, and also, does that philosophically meet the standard of increasing the enjoyment for everybody? The person who wins it gets it. But, you see what I mean? So there's all these philosophical issues, and I think it's a good thing, because we start talking about what we care about at a festival. It's great. The fun is put your money where your mouth is. I've talked a lot.
Thank you, Matt. Are there any questions?
Exactly, yes, that'll be in the Survey Monkey. Some of the Survey Monkey questions will be ratings 1 through 5.
Matt, repeat the question, please.
Oh, yeah, sorry. She was asking, is there some way to, on the Survey Monkey survey, to also allow people to suggest ideas for next year's fun activities? And of course, the answer is yes. Survey Monkey, you can either do numeral ratings or you can do fill in tests. So we could say, question number 10, the last one will be, what would you like to see happen with future fun? And you just type in your idea, and we'll get a database of that. You're welcome. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
How do we get on the Fun Fund Committee for next year?
Send me an email and state your willingness to be on it.
Good question, please.
All right. How do we get on the Fun Fund Committee next year? Send me an email stating your willingness to be a part of it and devote your time to it. Yes, sir. Will that committee be getting larger? You mean in terms of number seven? It was seven this year. Will it be 9 or 11 or 4? I don't have an answer to you yet. It could be any number, I suppose. If 20 people say they want to be on it, then maybe we got to nail it down a little bit, because you can't have a phone conference call with 20 people and everybody's all over the United States. But a workable number, I think 7 is minimal. I think we could go to 9, maybe, or even 11. You also don't want to have an even number because you don't want ties. Okay, further questions? Thank you. One other question. No, I understand what you're saying, and I think I can restate it clearly. Basically, you're asking us to put on the WebMonkey survey a field where people can not enter their name, it's going to be anonymous, but enter their skills, talents, professional connections that might help us. Is that correct?
IJA festivals. Are they too big? Are they too long? When we have a 5 or 6 day festival, that means extra hotel room nights. That means more meals. That means taking more time off for work for people. Are these things still viable for our association based on today's economic realities? I've been to 20 festivals. I remember festivals of 1,500 people, but they were only 4 days long. So maybe we need to change the formula, and I'd like all of the membership and, of course, the board to think about these things. So think about this year's festival and future festivals as well. We have to make the right choices so that we give the members what they want and that the IJA can continue to produce good festivals. I don't have a lot of other things to talk about this year, but I'd be happy to take any questions that you may have. Evelyn? We had 385 pre-registered. Question was, how many? What's registration at right now? We had 385 pre-registered. That included about a total of 30 cons. We've had, in round numbers, I would say about another 100 people show up who did not pre-register, who have bought gym passes, mostly for the week. I would say we're very close to 500 right now. And that's well below what I expected here in the middle of the country, in a very affordable city. So I'm a little disappointed, but I think it is the economy, quite frankly. Anyone else? Joyce, do you have a question? You, sir? Yes? Okay, question is, what's being done to promote our shows at Drone Club? A lot. City of Rochester has really supported us. We've been in the newspaper 3 times, and it's only the second day of our festival. We were on television this morning, 7 o'clock, live shot, and footage from our show last night. So we're in the local media. Rochester Magazine had a write-up that's a monthly. However, 60,000 people who work at the Mayo Complex received at their home address by paper mail last month a activities guide. It's put out by the city and the Downtown Alliance, and it talked about IJA. And this does not go to the doctor in his office. This goes to their home. So it's not in a huge stack of mail, and people look forward to this. They had discount coupons in there for all of our tickets. That's how we were able to get in there. So that went to 60,000 homes. 2 hours ago, I received my copy of the Rochester Downtown Alliance email blast, which also goes to over 60,000 email addresses in Rochester. And we were basically the entire issue. All of the events listed for the next 4 days are IJA shows, including planning the judgment seat and all of our evening shows, plus just that we're in town and we should come down to the Mayo Civic Center and check it out. So we've got a lot of publicity, and I won't know until tomorrow morning when we get a flash report from the box office on what our actual ticket sales were to the public. When you look around in the theater tonight, keep in mind that we had around, let's say, 350 tickets sold to our own attendees, and the downstairs at the theater seats 850. So you can gauge by that about how many tickets we sold to other people. And I'll be happy to report to the board or to anyone who asks how we're doing later in the week. Rick?
Real quick comment. I have family. My wife has family in the area. I know that the shows were promoted in local newsletters and papers in many of the towns, not within Rochester, but within 30 to 40 miles of Rochester. So there's been a lot.
That's right. As I was told when we first came to Rochester to look at the city for our festival, they said, and here in Rochester they have 80,000 highly educated, highly paid people with absolutely nothing to do. And a festival like ours with family-friendly shows open to the public is something they would love to have. And we'll see if they come through. I think they will. I saw a lot of local people in our show last night. That's right. The city's put up posters and claims on the skywalk. 100,000 people walk through that skywalk every day. So there's a lot of stuff out there. Any other questions? Dave?
Yeah, the European Juggling Festival is getting bigger every year. It's going to be 10,000 there this year, 6,000. And I just wonder if any
Dave's question is, why is EJC getting bigger and bigger with, I believe they had 6,000 people pre-registered for this year and 10,000 expected, and IJA is slowly shrinking, and I'm not qualified to answer that. And you, sir? Well, it would depend on each city. For this year, 500 pre-registered. The question was, how many people would we like pre-registered to guarantee a proper festival? Every year's financial model is a little different based on the negotiations with the city, but for this year, about 500 would almost essentially guarantee us a proper festival. If you're below that, but I think it's within reach. In the back?
Is it possible that Matt Hall might have input on the EJC versus IJA issue?
I defer to my good friend Matt Hall.
Certainly my experience with the EJC doesn't go back so far. 2003 was when I was an inviting guest to Spinboard Denmark, and that was about 2,300, 3,000, and they really liked that one. And then the next year, you had Carvan France, which was 4,000 plus, which was the new high for them. And after that was Ptuj in Slovenia, and that actually went down. It was like 1,800. And then after that, after Ptuj, they were in Ireland, and once again, 2,000. Like for them, that's low. Obviously for us, that's a dream. But once again, the trend is actually not doing this at EJC. It depends on the country and the organizing team that puts forth bids, which they vet every year at the business meeting of the EJC. And then after Ireland, it was Greece. And Cheryl was there with Doug, and that was a big one. That was 3,000, 4,000 plus, I think, super hot. Once again, Greece, but also disorganized and late. Every show started 3 hours late, and so forth. I'm not joking. And then after Greece was 2008, which was Karlsruhe, Germany, and that set the new record at 6,100. I was there, Lisa and I went for the first, she went for the first time. It was ridiculous. I'm gonna talk to you sometime. Amazing. 6,100, Germany, right? But Karlsruhe, which is like near the Bavarian border, and it's like having a fest in, I'm gonna pick a state, and some of these people are gonna get pissed or something, right? But it's a different, having it now, than having it in Munich. Now it was in Karlsruhe, they got 6,000 in Karlsruhe. Of course they're gonna get 9,000, 10,000 in Munich. It'd be like going from Mississippi to New York City. You're gonna get more. The Karlsruhe, Munich team has had a $2 million budget in 4 years. Working with the Munich City municipality. The city is essentially sponsoring it. They're hosting it on the Olympic site from the 72 Olympics. And it's always been the reputation, even Bremen in 2000, German festivals always go big because Germany, Berlin is probably the best juggling city on the planet right now, easily. I'd make that argument, I don't debate anybody. But, so you're gonna get 1,000, 1,500 just out of Berlin, and then another 1,000 out of the rest of Germany. Then you got, and it's located well, the infrastructure in Germany is top notch. So the Spaniards, the Italians, the Brits, the French, boom. Just that, not counting the Nordic countries. Last year in Joensuu in Finland, 1,400. See that difference? They're doing this depending on the country. So I don't think you can say it's just getting bigger and bigger and bigger and juggling in Europe is thriving and juggling in America is dying.
But they're still kicking our ass.
Yeah, exactly. They've always been doing that, and they always will.
Well,
there's no doubt about that.
And I'd like to point out that Western Europe is smaller than Texas. United States of America is a gigantic continent with mostly empty space. And if you want to travel across this country, you have to fly. We do not have trains. And it's a different culture here to travel, and we're just a much bigger place.
Different legal systems, different infrastructure things, different culture. Yeah, I mean, we can talk about this in the gym casually, but I know what I'm talking about. I'm not the expert, but Tarim and some of those guys on the IJA board are my friends. We've had this discussion. How can the IJA aid the EJC to get bigger numbers, and what can we learn from them? How can we be eclectic and take some of their stuff? To the degree that we can in this country, legalistically, I think we're headed in that direction, but it's not good. You're never going to see the IJA equal EJC, right? Never.
Any other questions on 2011 Fest?
Yes.
Mary?
What Matt was saying is that it's
appreciate your sentiment. The problem is we have to negotiate with hotels and facilities based on our proven track record. And our proven track record is what it is. And our high was 1,500 in Buffalo in 2004. We could never go to a city and say we want to reserve space in hotels for 12,000 people. And word association of 1,400 people. Yes. The realities of the business are that we can only afford as much space as we need. We can't afford to book space that we can realistically hope to fill. We'd be out of business the very next year. That's just the reality. Martin?
And if we booked space, that wouldn't bring the jugglers.
Correct.
The jugglers, as you say, in the U.S., in North America, have to travel thousands of miles. In Europe, they can take a train or drive a short distance. Europe is compact. If you want to get an EJC in the United States, you need to do two things. You need to take the United States and compress it into the size of the Northeast states, of three or four states in the Northeast. Compress it all into that size. And then you need to have municipalities there that are willing to have a few thousand campers camp out right next to a facility. And that doesn't happen anywhere in the U.S. Neither of those happens. And so it's just not going to be easy to have, you know, thousands of jugglers. Buffalo, by the way, only had 800 jugglers. If you count jugglers, not just spectators. 1,100 or 1,300 was probably our peak in St. Louis, Pittsburgh.
I meant to say 1,500 room nights.
Room nights? Oh, totally different.
Okay. Larry.
Just one comment. I've attended 20 festivals since 1978. We're a vendor here this year with my wife, TBA by Toshi. Every communication that I've received has been prompt, very well done. All the advertising, fantastic. The board of directors, the effort on everybody's part. It's the best I have ever seen. Mike, the board, and you guys deserve a wonderful round of applause.
Thank you, Mike. Mike, would you like to speak about 2012 now, or do you want to save that for later? No, but we figured we'd do it now.
Okay,
2012 IJA, Winston-Salem, July 16th, 22nd, next year. Hope to see you there. Great city, Iwanispan, we can afford it. If you remember the Embassy Suites, you can put six people in a room for $109, get a free breakfast every day. You are 2 minutes from the door of your hotel to the gym. It's a great city. We need a festival director for next year. If you are interested or know someone who may be, please inform the board of directors. Planning for Winston-Salem should have started the day this festival opened. So we need a festival director for next year. If you've never tried it or thought about it, it's a very rewarding experience, a lot of work. But IJA needs a festival director for 2012. That's about all I can think of to say about 2012.
Thank you very much. Question? Yes. That has been, the question is about choosing two or three cities to go between on in a rotation basis. And past boards have talked about that. We've never really come to a final decision on that. This board has talked about it as well. You know? We never really made a solid definite, yes, that's what we're doing. There are two bids, I believe, for 2002 strong bids for 2013 that the board will be looking at later this week. Which are Lexington, Kentucky and Bowling Green University. So one of those is a university format. It's in Ohio, I'm sorry, it's Bowling Green in Ohio, excuse me. They have not presented us with a proposal yet, correct, Mike?
They have told us they want us back, and paperwork that we could sign, but we're under no obligation to sign, and I believe that at our meeting on Monday to close this festival, they will give us a written proposal for 2013, or 14, or 15, whatever year we want to come back, because I'm nearly certain they do want us back very much.
Okay. Any other questions on that topic? Hearing none, we'll move on to the financial report. In your agenda, it says with Holly Greeley. Holly was not able to make this year's fest, so Kevin Macbeth.
Right, so the question was asking about the review of professional accountants, how we keep track of all this. So we have a bookkeeper on staff who prepares all the financial statements, and because of the size of the commission, we've actually had a separate certified public accountant review everything as part of our tax filing process. And we're also looking at getting actual auditing done so that we're eligible for a lot more grants that are given out to nonprofits. For example, supplement applied for the youth education.
I think it's not really necessary to do the hospital for the hospital.
lives for us. But we are double checking and triple checking things to make sure they're done correctly.
And then 2011, quarter two financial statements that are due from the bookkeeper by the end of the month. Got that after the review, and they should be available on the website. Any other questions on the finances?
Thank you very much, Kevin. The next report is the website team report. I don't know if any of our website team members are prepared for something. Kevin, can you hand the microphone to Mike Sullivan, please? You're Tom. Thank you.
Thank you, Kim. And what we're trying to do is to modernize the IJA's website, bring everything into one system. Right now, IJA is run by a collection of bolted together pieces by various people across the country, and we are creating more work for our volunteers and providing less service for our members than it could be. So through generous support of our donor, IWI, we have started a project to move the IJA to what's called an association management system. This would be one web-based system for our volunteers and staff to use that would run all aspects of the IJA. Membership, bookkeeping, event management, address updates, roster, store, all kinds of things that are now done with separate, disjointed, unconnected systems. And thousands of associations use these kinds of programs, and it's about time for the IJA to do so as well, so we don't burn out all of our volunteers. With the initial donation from our donor, we have contracted with a consultant who does this type of consulting, especially for nonprofits like ours. Aaron Stevens helped myself, David, and Martin Frost, David Landau, our webmaster, and Martin Frost, look at some consultants. We chose one, and as soon as things settle down after the festival, August 15th, we will have our first telephone meetings with the consultant to do a needs analysis. And after he does the first round of needs analysis discussions with us, he may also want to interview board members and other volunteers. And then after that, he will make a good, better, best recommendation for systems for the IJA to evaluate and eventually implement. And the idea would be that we would then transition off of all the disjointed systems that we have onto this platform over the next year. And move to a modern system. So that's the project, and it's about to get started next month.
Question?
Sir?
How much are we paying the consultant?
Can I disclose that, Kim?
I don't see why not. It's public record.
$5,000.
And just so I can add, Mike, that was actually an additional donation by IWI on top of the $50,000 that he gave us this past year.
And depending on which system we come to, they have various pricing models. Many systems are sold as a service where we don't buy any hardware or software. We simply pay a license fee per year and then possibly a fixed amount per member, like $1 or $2 per member. And they take care of all the programming, hosting, everything. So it can be very cost effective and, of course, give us a lot of capabilities we don't have now, a much more streamlined and efficient system.
Any other questions? All right, thank you very much, Mike. The next report is the store report. Sandy Brown and Kevin Macbeth take care of our store. Sandy was not able to make it to this year's fest, so Kevin will give the report, please.
So over the past year and a half, we've actually moved all the store distribution to working out of my place in Minnesota. And we also have IJA merchandise available in the register at the gym, 2007 through 2010 DVD 2-packs, as well as youth education program t-shirts, where the proceeds go to the youth education program. Any questions?
All right, seeing none. Thank you very much, Kevin. Membership report. do we have numbers for Maryland? Okay, I'll need to find that on my email.
Can I ask a question about the store?
Sure, sorry.
Have you looked into how much it would cost to move that out of your house into a warehouse or just into a that facility?
We have not. The question is how we have looked at how much it would cost to move it out of my house and into an actual like warehouse or storage distribution center. And we have not considered looking to see if Amazon's pricing would be and possibly in other places.
And we did use Amazon.com for the Jungle Vision DVD. It wasn't too successful at that time, that particular attempt with Amazon, but it's something to revisit.
Yeah. I don't know if Amazon's necessarily
the actual thing, but I know there are lots of global such facilities. Well, I find the membership report. The next report after that will be the education report. Aaron Stevens and Kevin Axtell are our education people. So I'll turn it over to Aaron and Kevin.
Hello. So I wanted to start just with reading the mission statement for the youth education program, so it gives you a bit of an idea of what it is and what our goals are. The mission of the Youth Education Program is to provide quality juggling instruction and education in schools and youth programs around the world. The goal is to challenge and empower young people in a fun, healthy, and rewarding environment while spreading the joy of juggling. This last year at the IJA in 2010, we did our first YEP certification where we trained 15 YEP reps, that's what they're called, YEP representatives, and they became certified. We needed $5,000 to implement a pilot program, and we generously received that from EWE, and led a 8-month pilot program, during which 3 pods went into schools, after-school programs, and boys and girls clubs, and taught youth. We taught over 150 young people how to juggle throughout that 8 months. Reports back, every YEP rep involved had a wonderful time. Every participant had a wonderful time, and the programs themselves that hosted the facilities were very impressed, very excited to have this as part of their programming. So we're excited about that and seeing where it'll go in the future. And then...
Great, so shortly, hopefully in the next 2 months, but maybe 3, we'll have a pilot program report, so you can see the numbers and the comments from the program directors. This year, we have 8 new YEP reps being certified, which brings the total to 23, and that's a range of how active each pod is from folks. We have 3 pods that are very active, and then everything in between. We want to focus on growing, but growing slowly and efficiently. Certainly, we don't want to what's the term? Get too big for our britches. I don't know. Overreach and make sure that we're doing it right. And we don't want to dilute the quality of the instruction. That's a big focus. It's not just juggling. I mean, I don't know how many of you were taught poorly to juggle when I was young. I wasn't taught very well. Anyway, we want quality instruction. Both. And lastly, we're going to move away from paying each instructor for every class. We want to still offer stipends to the instructors to do performances for their kids to inspire the juggling. But as the program grows, it's not feasible, the logistics, to work with so many small amounts of checks all over the place. And so there's also some grant work in progress.
Yeah, and so what Kevin was saying is, yes?
I have a question. Is there a method of measurement? Are you guys market the IJA to any people? I mean,
yes. So the question... So the question was, do we market the IJA to these people? We have a lot of different ideas. This is a new program, and we're definitely in the growth stage and development stage, and it's evolving. The pilot program taught us a lot, and we're kind of evolving to the next stage now. One of the ideas is a lot of the programs are going to be establishing levels, systems of rewards, such as the Jugheads have, where you learn five ball and that's and you reach next level. Thoughts about that is that we would have awards for those kids. One of those would be an IJA membership, is kind of the vision, eventually, things like that. The IJA is publicized on all brochures, websites that are integrated with the youth education program. So we do talk about it with the youth as well, saying, hey, you're part of this worldwide community of juggling. This is our local pod. We call them pods. This is our local pod, but you are part of a worldwide community. The IJA is the group that starts this. So it at least starts building the interest and ideally as kids continue to be involved. We also have talked about, let's see which kid gets to the highest level in their pod that year, and then we bring them out to the IJA, from each pod, different youth, through youth jugglerships, etc. So we're definitely pushing the IJA as well. Yes? Yes.
Can you use the microphone?
Okay, I think it's been a fabulous experience for me. I've loved the costumes and everything, but what I'd like to ask the question mainly, because I learned to play darts when I was a kid with my dad, and it was fabulous to play darts and have fun and see that there was things as well that you never saw to my mind. But my main question is that my understanding is, and correct me if I'm wrong, that because of that kind of person I know who's donated, you are donating money to help kids to learn how to juggle and do something in their life. So this is a pilot thing. How do you determine who you're going to help, because it's going to be too big a thing? Do you just help one organization in each city, or how do you go about doing that, and what's the amount that you can get in order to do this to help kids?
Right. Okay. So the model that we're kind of shifting to at this point is we have these 23 representatives. They're spread across the country. We have representatives in Texas, California, Colorado, Pennsylvania, Iowa, Arkansas, and more. Those people that are the YEP reps, they do the work in their individual community. What the main program of what the IJA YEP program does is we're acting as a support module to help those programs grow. So if somebody wants to establish their own youth education program, we give them the tools. We help with website design. We help with publicity. We have brochures for people. And we give scholarships for kids who can't afford a program if people are charging for their programs. Each program is responsible for their own structure that they'll be working in. So be it you want to volunteer for a half hour a week at a school and go teach, that's okay. That can still be under the branch. Or say you want it to be your primary income and you want to actually do a dance class type style where it's a juggling class instead and you're charging $12 an hour for kids to come participate every week, that's another style. So each pod's gonna be individualized. A lot of them also involve going into schools to do demonstrations. That's something that we're offering stipends for, where we give, say, $100 to encourage you to go and spread in your community that the juggling programs are happening. So, I don't know if that answers your idea.
And if I can interject as well, I think this will also help to answer the question. The way you become a YEP rep, as we call them, I know, is there is a 5-hour long workshop over 3 days that Kevin and Aaron and I run. It is by pre-registration, and we talk about various topics in there to help the YEP reps get some insight on how to get into youth programs, whether it be schools or recreation programs, how to deal with the administrative side of things, how to work within the YEP rep system as far as our paper trail that we have to create. But that is by pre-registration. We just had our first session today of the new training, and it was incredibly...
Yeah. Note, this is not an open workshop, but rather pre-registered YEP participants. If you would like to register, please contact blah, blah, blah. But that's the only place we put that, was in the Google Calendar. That's my bad.
Until next year.
do better at advertising it. It's again, we're trying to grow, but we're trying to grow sustainably, so we didn't want it to be open to 50 people, because that would be too much to try to work with 50 different pods at this time. So we're trying to do it sustainably, where we grow slowly, make sure that we as coordinators can help to organize it and make sure it's efficient over the year, and then add some more the next year. So, thank you. There was another topic, the grant writer. We do have a professional grant writer working with us. We have received our first grant of $1,300 to the Boulder Yet Pod. So they get to use that for rental space for their class. thank you. As well as for artist fees. So we're really excited about that. The grant writer is fantastic and is working with each individual pod right now to apply for local grants in those communities, so that we can build the funding and then eventually be able to apply for larger nationwide grants that would go to the overall budget. So that's that. I also, really quick under education, wanted to throw in a little bit about a program called Props to You, which is a program I started, I guess, in September or so. And the idea came about from talking to some jugglers in Ethiopia and finding them on Facebook. And one of them is now performing here, Melaku Lisanu. And they said that in the 1990s, Cirque du Soleil went and opened up a whole bunch of circus schools. But now that the funding is gone from that, they have juggling clubs that are breaking. They can't afford props anymore, so not many people were juggling, and they were turning to other circus arts. And any way we could get props to them to help with that teaching process, they would appreciate. So we developed Props to You. So far we got 300 balls and 60 plus clubs, cigar boxes, rings, Diablos that we sent to Afghanistan just in the last month. This went to the Mini Mobile Children's Circus in Afghanistan that serves over 300 kids on a weekly basis and teaches juggling. Even the girls are allowed to juggle. It's one of the only things they're allowed to do in the circus, which is beautiful. And we have a humongous bag that I carted on the airplane to give to Melaku Lisanu to take back to Ethiopia for the African Dream Circus.
Yeah, just one quick comment. I think this is probably one of the best, if not the best, program that IJA is doing when you're talking about philosophically rendering assistance to fellow jugglers. We all have old props that either, are just sitting there or whatever. You can ditch those. I sent a bicycle box. You know what I'm talking about? Like a big, mountain bike bicycle box that you send through the mail. I sent it full of all my juggling club. I wrote a grant for my juggling club at Silver Creek High School. We got money to buy new props. All our old props were dumped in the box. All the kids were throwing in the stuff that they use at home, their own props, not just the school props. And it weighed 50 pounds. And it only cost me, though, 40 bones, 40 bucks to send it to the main shipping site in LA. That's nothing. That's absolutely nothing. And we were down in Mexico, which we'll come up later. The best cigar boxer in Mexico was using my tissue boxes taped together. I gave him my Henry's boxes, and it was like I'd given him $1 billion. You know what I'm saying? Like, you want to see joy, you want to see happiness? Get your old props out and send that stuff, for sure.
Yep. And on that note, and this will be publicized wide as well, I'm the contact person for donations, so anyone interested in donating. We're having to find really creative ways to do shipping. We found out it cost about $700 to ship a 40-pound package to Ethiopia. And I had a little freak out moment, said, oh no, my dream isn't going to happen. and then we found an organization that does ship to Afghanistan. They send huge, ton shipments to Afghanistan of aid stuff, and they took all of our props on their shipment. So it was only, jugglers only had to pay for shipment to California, and it was taken care of from there. So we're being creative.
Any questions on education? If not, I did bring up the membership report. As of July 15th, Marilyn Sullivan, who is our membership director, reported a number of records at 1,252. Number of members, 1,500. Number of youths, 84. Number of families, 178. Number of lifetime members, 280. As of July 15th, there were 365
fest registrations, 12 special workshop registrations, and 109 benefit show tickets sold. And that is that report. If you do have questions, Marilyn will be in the gym, I'm sure, right, Mike? Okay. On to our next. Okay. Next report is marketing promotions, which is Tom Wall.
The idea of bringing juggers together and helping spread the love of juggling across the world than
sending a set of three balls to somebody in Germany, for example. We can talk more about that sometime if you'd like. I'd love to hear more ideas about how to expand World Juggle Day. I'm only one guy. Aaron helped me quite a bit this year as well. One of my two people. So. I believe it's on some official registry.
It's usually the closest Saturday to June 16th. 17th, my mistake. Thank you.
So yes, back to the World Juggle Day. Basically, the old format also put, in my mind at least, an undue strain on some vendors, basically constantly coming back to vendors and asking for things to donate to randomly selected individuals around the world. That's kind of, in my mind, that's kind of strange. So the way that World Juggle Day, the current format, sort of dovetails with the video tutorial contest is we're reallocating the, our vendor friendship capital, or whatever you would like to call it, in a way that is more constructive for the for the global government community. If you look at the total number of videos that have been produced just in the past 2 years since the inception of the video tutorial contest, there's a net of something like 200 or 300,000 views. So I mean, that's a really big number, and I was impressed with it. Taylor Glenn also made the World Juggle Day video this year. We had a little project where jugglers from across the world sent in video clips, and we got edited down to a very nice video. You can find it on the IJA video website. I feel like it has a very positive, inspiring message. I encourage you to watch it. It's youtube.com/IJA video. See it there. So I think that's all I have. Does anyone have any questions? Yeah?
I was just going to say, I think the video tutorial contest is probably one of the most important marketing things the IJA is doing right now, because before I came to IJA 2009, I had never met anybody else who could juggle, so legitimately everything I knew about it was from the internet, and so I think I found the IJA just because of a video simply taken at one of the festivals, and that's how I got involved with all that. So if it hadn't been for like YouTube and tutorials, then I would still think that behind the back was like a pin. just one behind the back throw with three balls. But yeah, so that's just my two cents about that specific project.
I'd like to point out that it's Tony Stanbach. He's helping me run vendors now, and if he had not won the first video tutorial contest, he probably wouldn't be here and donating his time to the organization. So that's pretty cool. Historically, there has been a video. The question was if there's going to be a video to buy of every convention. That has been the case. There was some issue with copyright, so we had to pull some videos off the store, but we do intend on making a DVD of every festival from here on out. I think we've had a video since 87. Somewhere in the 80s, maybe. So that's a lot of IJA video.
And just to add to that, we just started a new project where we are taking all of the old videos, including some real video, I understand, beta, that kind of thing that we have in our archives, and that's all being transferred by JCO onto several terabyte hard drives right now, so that we'll have a couple different sets stored in various places, so that those will always be archived.
I just want to thank the first time I came, I didn't know anyone. But this one, everybody's opened their hearts and helped me to learn. I just want to thank all the board members for the hours you do put in to help, because what I want to do is to do it with the kids as possible. And each one so that she could go back to Edmonton and say, Professor, whatever his name is, Finnegan. He said when he, about 2 years ago, maybe when you learn to juggle, you're going to have everybody else. So I do it on the buses, I do it everywhere. I never got my juggling board. I get into trouble sometimes, but I don't care. They know me on the bus and said, we want you the whole ride. So I want to thank IJA for helping me make this a very measurable and fantastic. And I don't, I'm going to stay up late, I don't like to stay up late, I'm going to join the pilot tonight. And thank you.
Does anyone have any other questions about marketing promotion, vendors, or okay? YouTube, yeah.
You talked about promoting the IJA, and you said you have these 17 vendors here, and I wonder if there's any way with the legal, if there's any legal ramifications to getting our logo on the tops of these cells, and some of them. Would we have to pay them, would they have to pay us for the logo, or would that work? It's just an idea. It's, you know, say, people say, well, I've never heard of IJA, but you've got a prop that says IJA right on it. There you go.
That is an interesting idea, and I have discussed that not at great length, but briefly with some people. And, I would like to talk to some vendors around here, specifically Higgins Brothers. I know that they do a lot of screen printing things. But I'm certainly no expert in anything. No, but specifically copyright and visual. But I do think it is possible, and I think that's something that would be worthwhile exploring, especially once we get the ideas about distribution center figured out, because that would be a pretty heavy burden on whoever does when that shit does comes out. But I'm interested in talking about that, to be certain.
That might tie in really well for vendors coming.
That comment was that would tie in well with the vendor discount program. Should somebody buy something at a discount, they would come with an IJA logo on it. I think that's also a very interesting idea, and I'd be willing to discuss that some more when we have some time. So, thanks.
Any other questions for marketing and promotions? Okay, thank you, Tom. Next, we're going to have a report on the magazine, which I will present. And I'm going to try and keep this somewhat brief because the board hasn't had a chance to necessarily review proposals yet. This year, at the end of 2011, will be the end of our present contract with Jungle Magazine, with Alan Howard, I should say, of Jungle Magazine. And we've already started a process, which is, I believe, the most formal bid process we've ever gone through, especially for the magazine. The board has actually established a timeline where we sent out a call for bids. We put together a bid packet with the specifications that we're kind of looking at, asking for samples of work, so that we can get some solid bids and really know what we're doing. There was a second call for bids that went out in mid-June, June 15th, and bids were due in this week. We have received three bids through email at this point, which the board will take a look at hopefully later this week, and go from there. We have been receiving, as requested in the e-newsletter and some other publications, input from the membership. Do we stay print? Do we go digital? Is there another way of supplying that member benefit in some way other that we may not be thinking of? We have asked for input and we have gotten it. I would love to hear from a lot more members, but we have received, I would say about 2 dozen or so emails. Yeah, ballpark about 2 dozen emails, and that's not counting postings on the forum and people we've just talked to, as far as their input and what they would like to see happen with the magazine. magazine. By all means, the board decided that with these bid packets, we can deny all bids that come through. We can put things out on rebid if we choose to. We're not locked in, and we're very open to ideas on what to do. So you just need to talk to us, let us know what you would prefer. We have tried Jungle Vision, which was a DVD format magazine a couple years ago, and that was a very expensive proposition to the tune of approximately $11,000 for the one DVD. So it was pretty much close to as expensive as the print magazine. We have put information out to membership. Try to at least, if you haven't gotten that information, I'd be happy to share it with you, with a breakdown of exactly, you know, here's what the printing cost is per year, or per issue. Here's what administrative costs are. Here's what writing costs are. Here's what mailing costs are. I do have all of that information and would be glad to share it because it is part of public record at this point.
Where did you say that information is also available?
The breakdown we were supposed to be putting out in the question was where else is that information available? We will actually have it coming out in the e-newsletter, okay? But I do have it here with me now as well. Okay. So we are keeping options open. We do have the e-newsletter, which Don Lewis does a fabulous, fabulous job with. But we have to decide because it does say that the IJA membership receives a publication of some sort. So we kind of have to decide what we want to do and go from there. I know that's not much of a detailed report, but just so you all do know, we do have three bids in. I'm sure board members have been busy with the festival. We haven't had a chance to look at them in detail yet. Yes?
Ballpark, how do the three bids compare with our contract?
The question is, how do the three bids compare to the current contract? Honestly, I haven't looked that closely at them to give an answer to that at this point. Okay. The bid process was supposed to close as of last evening. We did put the call out at the beginning at midnight, I believe it was. Yeah, it was almost 2 months ago that we put out the first call for bids. So we can talk about it later, Mayor. Okay?
Sure.
Any other questions? Yes.
Just a comment that I love the magazine and will cry if it stops. And I know a lot of people do agree with that, and it's a contentious issue, but I love the freaking magazine.
Okay. Was everyone able to hear that one? I'll
wonder how much he's willing to pay for it.
That's a good question. Martin asked, how much would you be willing to pay for it?
Not on your own, not the whole thing.
That is actually the question that board members for the past few boards have been tackling. And we have raised membership dues twice over the last 3 years? 4 years. Over the last 4 years, we've raised dues twice. And reluctantly. But we're trying to get the gap between your membership dues and the cost of the magazine like this instead of like this. And we're coming closer. Yes, question?
How detailed is the breakdown of costs that I've seen in the market? Something I can share?
Yes.
This sounds like the breakdown that you got from an individual who did not make this product.
That's true. I apologize for that. So I cannot make it public at this time. I can give you kind of percentages. That I can do is kind of what the most cost is. Because that's been made published already. That's been published.
Can you explain real quick how many percentages you made public?
Because it's part of the bid process right now. that would actually put people at a disadvantage. Yeah. The question was about, has the board or the organization looked into self-publishing? And would you mean as self-publishing with a volunteer being in the editor-publisher position?
Probably.
Okay.
Hopefully I'm not volunteering.
No. Not yet. We have discussed that, not only this board, but past boards. It is such a monumental job. I've spoken to the person who did the editing and publishing of Juggler's World, past issues of that, and they'll get us, yep. And even in our conversations, he said it's a huge, huge job for an individual to volunteer to do. And that's one of the things the board kind of has to look at, is what is doable by a volunteer. And what services do we actually need to pay for? Because it's just too big of a job for a volunteer. And we're kind of at that now. And we are looking at different options. Like I said, we're willing to listen. We're willing to put ideas on the board. We're not going to turn any idea down at this point, you know, if it's a feasible idea. So if you know someone willing to volunteer, we'd be willing to listen. The question is, can we use any of the donation money from IWE to fund the magazine? That is a no. That is part of the original contract with the donor, with IWE, that none of this money be used toward the magazine. That's one way to do it, and that's a possibility. Any other questions?
I'll just make one. There is also There's some discussion on the IJA's online forum, on the open discussion forum about this, so you can see some of the ideas that have been proposed. There's been a lot of discussion actually for the past like a month or two. So I would recommend that you take a look at that and see what you think and add your voice to the discussion that's ready at hand. Because there has been a substantial talk.
And this is an issue that we do need to decide by the end of 2011. So that we either don't miss an issue or we go in a new direction. Any further questions on the magazine?
Are we leaning one way or the other?
I can give you my personal opinion. Personally, I would hate to see the print magazine go because I am a print person. As a board member, I've got to do what's right by the organization and what the organization can afford. That means I'm not on either side yet as a board member.
I'm a huge advocate of the magazine, as everybody knows who knows that. But I have been recently transformed to really open my mind to other options by my good friend Tom. We're very good friends, we do differ on this specific opinion. But I would like to think there's some way we can somehow keep it. But it is a financial burden, and it's a good question how we're going to do that.
I want to start by saying I love the magazine and have enjoyed it. I've even learned lots of tricks and gotten help kind of professionally as a juggler from the magazine. Having said that, I think the long-term sustainability of the magazine isn't there at the present. I think that to continue to grow as an organization and get young people, we're talking about apps, the internet, digital. That's my idea of the future. I do like the magazine. I'd love to keep it. I feel like I represent a lot of people who love the magazine, and therefore I continue to want it to continue. My long-term idea in my mind is that it's not going to last. That's just me.
Yeah, I've been writing for the magazine since 2005. I was on the cover in 2007. What does that tell you about how I care about the magazine? You know what I'm saying? But at the same time, what everybody else said, it's got to be sustainable. It's got to be affordable. And I agree with Kevin that digitally, I think that's where most people are going. Gabby Keats from Cascade in Germany is looking to go digital at some point. Elser Kentz is a great magazine that's completely digital out of Argentina and serves the Latin American juggling community. And I know because I write for them too now. And I've seen ways it can work. So we'll see. Like again, somebody might knock my socks off with a print magazine proposal. I'll vote for it. But if not, then we need to move on.
Just to restate, it was $64,000
for four issues. That's the yearly cost.
And 1,600 publications four times a year.
So, you get the math. Will?
I don't subscribe to any other magazines, but I would pay extra to keep my own print copy of that. So, you know, hopefully
that's an option. Those are things we've been floating around, ideas were floating, maybe we do this, maybe we do, maybe we go print and digital. We don't know yet, we just don't know.
That is an idea that's not only been discussed by this board, but by the prior board, just to this one, that there be a tiered membership system to give the members a choice of whether they want to be digital magazine subscribers or print.
And again, as much as I love the magazine, and I really do, I think what's probably going to happen is there's going to be a transition stage between print to digital. So one of the things I could be advocating in this meeting sometime this week is that we do get another contract for maybe as long as 2 years, because I think it's going to take 2 years to actually get that other thing ready. But I want to make sure that other thing's ready before we just say goodbye to the magazine. So that's really my standpoint on that.
Is the mic on now?
Yeah.
Okay. Actually, I need to step in and make sure the numbers are correct. So the specific Juggle magazine expenses, as displayed on financial statements, are $55,575 per year.
My mistake.
But There's also a way that advertising and some of the other revenue work supports around. That's not the exact expense. So there's that could be a few thousand off based on that. But that's a give you a quick idea that the membership revenue from 2010 was 35,753. So that's about a $20,000 gap between the two. So that money comes from other things, such as the best.
Kevin? There's a search magazine called Spectacle Magazine. Has anybody ever seen that? And Spectacle has a way that you can be a sponsor, and on the inside cover of their magazine, which is a beautiful magazine, you can choose to pay $100 to be a sponsor for that membership to get that magazine, while regular membership is $40 a year or something like that. Now, having said that, that magazine is about to expire in two more issues, and they're going digital, so that says something.
Has there been any research into how other magazines are remaining profitable in this digital age?
Yeah, I mean, the truth is, if you look at that world, it's all going to digital. Magic Magazine, which is a very popular magazine, they have some benefits we don't because they have, there's a million businesses who sell magic props, so they have a large ad revenue that we don't have because there's not that many juggling makers, prop makers. They also are transitioning, I think. They still produce the print magazine, but they have a beautiful iPad app for their magazine that's sitting right here. It is a beautiful, when you look at it, it really can sway you from a print magazine to this. So even that magazine, that's just an example I know of, Magic Magazine, is really, I think, in a long-term transition stage. That's my observation on that. I could be totally wrong.
There's a moral dimension here that I have to bring up. The carbon footprint of a print magazine is huge. The carbon footprint of a digital magazine is very small. And I think we all have to think about the carbon footprint of everything we do. And that may be a reason not to have a huge festival, but to have regional festivals. That's a whole other topic.
Borders just finalized its plans to close all 399 shops by January.
Yeah.
Financial Times yesterday.
Wow.
They start in September. They'll be gone by January.
And I live not too far from Rodale Press, which publishes Runner's World magazine. And so just out of curiosity, a couple weeks ago I gave them a call and asked about how Runner's World distribution is going, and they said numbers are declining rapidly. And that's for Runner's World.
I'm studying journalism at my university right now, which is wrapped in, I don't like broadcast or PR, but it's wrapped into like magazine print and stuff. And every single class we have to learn the print and the online, because they're just telling us you're not going to be a job. Because like Time Magazine right now is really slipping downhill and not getting issues sold or anything like that. And so, unless the community, like the juggling community, is set up to support the issues in magazine stuff, it can be really hard to market such a specific kind of magazine. You can't sell the general magazines.
Gutenberg is rolling over in his grave.
Not just magazines, it's the whole print, newspapers,
yeah.
Everything.
Yeah.
You said that the largest chunk of costs for the magazine are editing. Do we get to save on editing if we switch to digital?
That's one of the conversations we've had, that it kind of depends on where the bids are, and the bid packets have asked for a bid for print, bid for digital, and a bid for a combination of the two. So we'll have to kind of look and see where those bids came in. When Anthony Shave was looking at the contract 2 years ago and working on it, there was not a significant savings. And by significant, I mean it wasn't more than a several thousand dollars difference between digital and print. But that was at that time, huh? That was 2 years ago. It may be different now. Yes?
Just like kind of point out that to me in the magazine or whatever we're talking about, is it's the content that's really important. And it depends, or may not wind up saving tons of money if we don't have, you know, I hope we don't skimp on the money for the content and how we see what's presented. So it may still be that this is going to be an expensive thing, mm-hmm. and not, we just won't have a print copy of it, but I hope the organization as a whole is going to help support the, you know, the documentation of this culture in one format or another. So I still see, in my view, I still think that we need to encourage the larger membership and maybe the membership fees might still even go up. But I'd like to see that for the continuation of the content of whatever we produce.
Yes.
I'd just like to throw out there for future possibilities that there is a new and upcoming technology called digital paper or e-ink. And this is like a type of paper where we could actually send members a magazine, but then every time a new edition comes out, it actually kind of erases it and downloads it onto a form of reprintable paper in a way. So for those of us that choose not to purchase iPads or the like, we could pay the extra tiered account balance to receive a one-time physical magazine, but then you don't have to keep shipping me a magazine every time. You just give me a one-time e-ink paper. This isn't going to be viable for another 2 or 3 years, but that's the time frame y'all are talking about anyway. So, you know, I would still pay for that over only having to download the thing onto my computer.
I'd be interested in talking more about that after the meeting.
Sure.
Or sometime in the week.
Absolutely.
Yes. The question is if we looked into any other formats like online videos and such with interviews. First of all, we do have a monthly newsletter. Have you been a member of the IJA for long? Doing the e-newsletter, correct me if I'm wrong, kind of attached to a video and with more content such as biographies and things on different jugglers. Don Lewis is our e-newsletter editor, and it is a completely volunteer publication. If he has someone to write biographies and different types of stories, and correct me if I'm wrong, Don, but you're willing to accept them, correct?
Address that, and a thought or a vision that I have and would like to see us head towards is a highly developed website with not just monthly segments, but we want frequent traffic. For example, Sensei's blog, right? Or interview of the week, hotspots, trick of the day, video tutorial, you know, drawing from that other thing, something to keep traffic. So, you know, it's long term, but kind of addressing what you're saying is other formats, other ways of delivering the information periodically.
I think we're caught in the trap of distributed media, that we've all been used to getting newspapers, magazines, and now we get this nice monthly disc or whatever, or it's a download, but instead, it's all going to eventually go to a website that we approach. and it's like HuffPost. It'll be a place where we go to find information, and it'll be rich because it'll have lots of blogs from everybody, and anybody can volunteer to be a blogger on there. And I think that's what we're headed towards as a culture in all of our activity areas. And so it would be good of us to get a lead on that instead of fighting for a magazine, when instead we should be fighting for first place in line to be knowledgeable about and to utilize the new media. So it's a whole new world, and I think it's really a different discussion. It's not, do we want to keep the dying magazine in a world of dying magazines, or do we instead want to enter a new world and see where that takes us? And that's a whole different discussion that we don't have time to do right now.
All right, yeah, I just wanted to say I do have a thought about this too, about needing a new website front end. We're talking about getting a new AMS system, which is all back end. A lot of the user, or a lot of the membership might not even notice when we do get a new AMS. But a new website, as Kevin was talking about, it was an association management software.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so we're planning on getting an entirely new front end. It's the question of how that front end works. If we're going to go digital, as I see it at the moment, we just don't have the infrastructure to do that on our own web presence. I don't really think there's any contest about that. If there is, let me know. I'll get to you in 1 second anyways. Yeah, so if we do get rid of the print magazine, that's a, what is it, $55,000 ballpark that we're freeing up every year. And if that money is divided up in several different ways, it's divided into printing and shipping, it's divided into content, and it's divided into layout. If we do put this onto a blog roll, you know, this is paid quality, magazine quality content, we're getting rid of printing and shipping, and we're getting rid of layout. So that frees up effectively somewhere between one half and two thirds of that $55,000. So we could even, you know, increase the amount of content we're producing, you know, 150%. So that's more magazine content for less magazine cost. And I've been toying around with the idea of the IJA getting registered as a publishing house. We can buy some ISBNs, it's very cheap. And we would be able to print basically a book every year of the content we produce. It would be 150% of, you know, magazine. It wouldn't be printed in magazine, it would be printed in a book form. We could release that annually. There would be some layout involved with that. It's just a thought. You can read more about that on the open discussion forum, but there are some other ideas in Twitter and toss around. So, yeah. You had a question, Dan?
My question was about the AMS software that we're looking at. What mobile applications?
I'm not sure. Once the consultant that we're speaking with has some kind of answer for us, we'll be able to answer that. That will be for a few months probably. I'm not informed enough to answer. Yeah. So, thanks.
Any other questions on the magazine issue? If not, we have one last report. Erin with the IRC report.
All right, so the IRC stands for the IJA Regional Competitions. And I'm happy to announce that we held our first IRC in Mexico in June, and it's a project that Tom Wall and I have been working on for the last year. The original presentation was to potentially have in Costa Rica, then we think about Peru, and finally we were like, oh wait, Mexico's our neighbors, let's go there. And it was phenomenal. It was incredibly well received. It was basically the IJA style competition, like we have here with the championships, taken to a regional festival in Mexico called Barullo, and held up their circus festival. And we had 13 competitors compete. We had prelims, which took it down to 8 competitors. The response was amazing. People were excited about it. The audience at the actual competition was packed and energetic and incredible. incredibly thrilled to be watching this competition. We had first, second, and third place, and in our first place position we had Fer Sumano, the only female competitor. And as she won, she broke down in tears, screaming, the audience was screaming, and they lifted her up on her shoulders, and it was a brilliant moment.
We have video.
It will be coming soon. So Kevin, Matt, and myself were all present for this, and made a great team for putting on this first regional competition in Mexico. The Mexicans are excited about the IJA. Many people came up to me afterwards saying, please do this again, Sorry, I have a really bad Mexican accent. this year we had 13 competitors, next year we will have 30, things like that. They said South America will be really excited about this style of competition as well. For the next step, we're looking at going to South America. Brazil is currently having their 13th annual competition, and they're interested in having us for 2012. It's just really exciting to get the IJA out to other parts of the world, bring in that international title a little bit more strongly. And also now that they've been exposed to the IJA and they actually know kind of what the IJA format looks like, there's at least 10 people who are like, oh, I will see you on Winston-Salem. So they're planning to come here as well. So it was a life-changing experience for me to go to a festival where I didn't know the name of a popular juggler. I didn't know who the top jugglers were. I didn't know what the scene looked like, what the styles were, and just to be exposed to this whole other culture of juggling that was beautiful, polished, talented individuals that are part of our international juggling family.
It was absolutely incredible. I just want to kind of point out the difference between maybe having some IJA flyers or an IJA table in the corner at an event to having the competition. Everyone at that festival knew what the IJA was because that competition was a centerpiece. And so I think that the difference in exposure you can't compare it. It was talk to us individually about our experiences down there outside of the competition, but total success. I bow to Aaron and Tom for bringing that. I mean, International Jugglers Association.
And Niels Dunker is our current IJA rep in Europe. Tom, right? Niels Dunker, right? And he was my host when I was at the Dutch Juggling Convention, and he's stepped up, and now he's really keen, really motivated to push the IJA in any way he can, and say the EJC, and in Europe. He's working on translations of all our flyers and posters and pamphlets, and that's cool. He's totally all about that. As far as competitions, maybe that's not going to work at the EJC, because they have the open stage, and they have their different circus competitions already. In Japan, the JJF, the Japanese Juggling Federation, has IJA style competitions already that I believe Dick Franco helped set up when he founded that fest and helped fund that fest. So Japan's already taking care of business. But yeah, Latin America, I think, is the place where things are going to start blowing up and where we can make a lot of inroads. I've been to more than 100 festivals all over the world, and this competition, I think the IJA competitions could take a note or two from how it was run. It was low key, nobody got stressed about procedure. There's not like nitpicking, oh, you scored at 1.5, it's really 1.7. You know, but we ran the competition. We used the current judging Excel sheets. We posted the scores. It was all transparent, but relaxed too. A little dirt field in a circus tent on a stage that you hear, you'd just be like, I'm not even going to step on that. I'll die. But they competed. It blew my mind. Same thing. It really. Just this year, I went to Britain, Israel, and Arkansas, and Mexico. Arkansas the most wild, I guess. But, Jared Davis. Okay. But I'm saying, the Mexican Fest rocked my world. And the competitions, when you see the video, you will not believe it. With the footage Kevin shot and I shot, we could put out a 90-minute DVD, and that's, or a download. No more DVDs, got to be downloads, West Beacon style. That's going to sell. There's so much good footage. Mexican jugglers are insane. And they're IRC.
We will also, there were the countries that we have heard interest from so far are Mexico wants us back for a second year next year. We're looking at South America, Brazil, Argentina, and Chile. The juggling students are phenomenal, and I don't think many folks up here in Little, I call it white field, know much about the South American scene, and it's phenomenal. Also, Israel has shown interest, and Africa. So it's really exciting to see where this could go. The other thing that I want to say is the winner of that competition, we will be proposing, it's not guaranteed, but proposing to the Fun Fund to fly in the winner of the IRC competition to come either compete, they can enter the prelims and compete, or to perform in the final show, the gala show, or Cascade of Stars, yes. So she's really excited about that. So, any questions about the IRC? Circus festival, so there was juggling, there was clowning, there was aerial artists.
Three groups, acro, clowns, jugglers.
Mm-hmm. Hula hoopers, all kinds of different things.
Live workshop boards by what discipline you want to learn.
Yeah, so there's a lot of different format.
Where was this in Mexico?
This was right by Guadalajara, about an hour outside in a dirt field, as Matt Paul said.
Dirtiest I've ever been.
And the most fun I've ever had. If you want any good stories, ask about the Renegade show. Yeah, so thanks. All right, any questions about the IRC? If not, that one. Thank you. I'm sorry the reports took so long, but as you can tell, hopefully by them, this board has been busy. And we've been busy not only here in the U.S., but also with the YEP program. Aaron and Kevin didn't mention this, but we've had international interest in YEP reps being certified in other countries. So that has already gotten international recognition, as well as the IRC, as well as vendor discount program, because we have international vendors part of that. Props to you, definitely. This board has been working hard to really get the IJAs out there and known and bring people to us. So we thank you for being members and being part of it. We'll move on to the elections part of the agenda. It's just very, very quickly, those who are running for election this year, there are three seats open on the board. I am one of the people up for re-election. Dave Pawson is running for election, and Tom Wall is running for re-election. And usually we have those running for election say a few words if they wish. Tom, do you wish to say anything?
How's it going, Tom? Basically, I'm running for re-election so I can continue working on the programs that I have been working on for the past 2 years. I think they've been met with some success and some support. And I'd like to see it continue and get bigger.
Dave?
So I've had a lot of this discussion with many people already, so for those people who are in the audience, I'm sorry because I'm sure I'll repeat myself a bit, but I think we're cool and you're not too disappointed in me yet. For all the people I haven't talked to yet, who are saying, who is this guy? Why is he up there? Why is he running the board? I'll catch you up a little bit. I was in Sparks last summer and I left really energized, really motivated. It was my biggest exposure to the community yet and wonderful people in it, so that's something more involved in. I was there when we wrote the announcement of the donation we received and the fund committee that was going to be formed, and so I contacted Matt Hall and said, hey, if you could use help, that's something I'd like to help with, a good way to kind of get my foot in the door, learn more about this. So I worked on that committee with Matt and others. It was a blast, it was very interesting, challenging at times, but I think all in all came out pretty well. And when that all ended up, you know, we had signed up to decide what the money should be spent on. I don't think we necessarily signed up to then do it all. do all these cool things and they're not going to happen. And that's how I ended up organizing the busking competition. Friday 1 to 3 in Peace Plaza, I would strongly encourage you all to be there. It should be a blast. Now, at that point, I certainly wasn't thinking of running for the board, maybe sometime in the future, as I got more involved and more involved. But Warren Hammond, who had also been on that committee, said, hey, you should run for the board. Great idea. I was later at the festival talking with Tom Wall and said, crazy old Warren, and said I should run for the board. And Tom stared me in the face and said, yeah, you totally should run for the board. Talked to Matt said the same thing. I talked to Kevin, who said the same thing. And we had a lot of discussions after that, but the thing that really stuck with me is they said, okay, sure, you could wait, you'll meet more people, you'll learn more about the organization, but in doing so, you'll also get more used to the way things are. The fresh perspective you have now will start to just blend in with what everybody else already knows. And really, I think the bottom line is, and you can tell in a meeting like this, there's a lot of good ideas people have. There's a lot of, couldn't we do this, couldn't we do this?
The group of people up here on stage with me is an incredible group of people. And we have worked our tails off. And I am so proud to serve with them. And there are so many ideas out there. And when I was considering running again, I talked to Rob, my other half, and we had a bit of a discussion and talked to a few other people, and I was like, okay, I can do this one more time. So if you're interested in having me one more time, I'd appreciate your vote. If you'd rather get somebody else, write it to welcome. But that, it's been an absolute pleasure to serve on this board and all the boards I've served on. It's just gotten better each and every year, so I can't imagine not doing this. There will be one board member leaving us, Kevin McBeth. Kevin McBeth is not running for re-election, and we will be in need of a treasurer, if anyone's interested. Now's the time. But we'll also need a store manager as well, so we'll be looking for those positions. Would you like to say anything, Kevin? Okay.
It's a lot of work.
Kevin has done an amazing job. Kevin is about the most accurate person I know with finances, and apparently there was a bit of a problem with the cash register the first day. And in his type A personality, he went off and spent 3 hours or more?
Three hours last night
fixing the mistake with the cash register. So that is incredible. Most people would have given up. So that was awesome. Yes?
So to clarify, there's three empty spots and three people running, and even if you each got one vote each, then that would be the three new members.
Depending on write-ins, because we always get some write-in votes.
Votes. Probably dozens of people got a vote.
Colorful.
Imaginative people will be nominated too. But...
Mickey Mouse?
Yeah, he's gotten a few.
We have a few politicians every year and things like that.
Enrico Rastelli.
And once this meeting has come to adjournment, there will be 30 minutes left of voting time. And after 30 minutes past our adjournment time, the voting will be shut down and votes will be tabulated. Okay. Just so you're all aware of that. Next on the agenda is new business. Is there any new business to discuss today? Okay, if there is none, we will move on to announcements. The next board meeting. The next board meeting will be held at some point later this week after we find out the results of the election. It is traditionally published in the daily newsletter, so it will be in tomorrow morning's daily newsletter when the next meeting will be, and the place and time when it will be. So please check your daily newsletter. We'll also have them make an announcement in the gym for anyone who is interested, because board meetings are open to the membership. Are there any further announcements?
Yes.
I just want to announce officially that I will not be doing workshops next year. And the only reason that I'm saying that is because I think it's a position that more people should run through. New, fresh ideas should come in. Agam Rafaeli from Israel and Fire Safety Dave from Britain, those two guys and me have put up a Google Doc on how to run workshops at big festivals that we're working on all the time. If anybody wants a link to that or an invitation to that or our Google Doc, you can see what I put down, what Agam put down, and what Dave put down. Workshops is doable, for sure. But those of you who are here, spread the word. I'm not doing it next year, so we definitely want somebody to start working on that, or to step forward and know that it's going to be happening, you know, starting next February, January, when I have somebody in place already. So let the word go forth.
Yeah.
I'm out.
Any other announcements?
So one really quick last thing. I'm going to be putting a big suggestion box out near the reg table, so if you guys think of anything that you want to be piped directly to the board instead of walking up and talking to one of us, we sort of telephone it along. We'll be taking any suggestions, any comments, anything about what we've been talking about in this meeting and otherwise. I think it's really important that we have a straight line of communication here, especially with some of the it's more critical decisions that are going to be made in the next year. So be on the lookout for that. Bring it down. Thanks.
Are we supposed to be electing a new chairperson?
The election of the chairperson actually happens among the board members. That will happen officially in our next meeting.
So it's y'all who vote amongst yourselves?
Right.
Depending on if anybody wants the job. Yeah.
Do you want the job?
I'm not on the board yet.
Maybe.
I know, but I don't want to upset
anyone. Any further announcements?
Good.
Okay. If there are none, next on the agenda is the adjournment. If there is not any further business to come before the meeting, we will adjourn. Okay. Is there anyone opposed to adjourning at this time? If not, the meeting is adjourned at 5:44 p.m. Central Time. Thank you all, everyone.